Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in 2017. Could I ask everyone in the room to ensure that their mobile phones are on silent? It's acceptable to use mobiles for social media within the room, but please don't take photographs or film proceedings. Agenda item one is subordinate legislation. We have two negative instruments today. The first instrument is the sale of tobacco and nicotine vapour products by persons under 18. Scotland Regulations 2017, SSI 2017-50. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Can I invite any comments from members? No comments? Is it agreed that we make no recommendations?
Agreed.
Thank you. The second instrument is the Sale of Tobacco Register of Tobacco Retailers, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2017, SSI 2017-51. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instruments. Again, could I invite any comments from members? Nope. Is it agreed that we make no recommendations? Thank you very much. The second item on the agenda is the first evidence session on the preventative agenda. This is a round table session. I'll introduce myself and then we'll go around the table if people can very briefly introduce themselves to the committee. My name is Neil Finlay. I'm the convener of the Health and Sport Committee at MSP for the Lothians.
Good morning. My name is Claire Hawkey. I'm the MSP for Rutherglen and the deputy convener of the committee.
Hello, I'm Ellie Hothersall. I'm a consultant in public health medicine at NHS Tayside.
Hi, I'm Gerry McCartney, consultant in public health at NHS Health Scotland.
Donald Cameron, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
David Bell, Professor of Economics, University of Stirling.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Alex Cole Hamilton. I'm MSP for Edinburgh West End. I'm also a Lib Dem health spokesperson.
Alison Johnston, MSP for Lothian.
Damien McIlvenny, statistician and epidemiologist at the Institute of Occupational Medicine.
Neil Craig, Principal Public Health Advisor in NHS Health Scotland.
Good morning, Richard Lyle, MSP for Uddingston and Belsham.
Marie Todd, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Eveline McHugh, Chief Officer of the Midlothian Integrated Joint Board.
Mairi Simpson, Public Health Practitioner with Midlothian Health and Social Care Partnership.
Good morning, I'm Fraser McKinley, Director of Performance Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland.
Ivan McKee, MSP for Glasgow Proven.
Okay, thanks very much. We have a few people missing this morning, but I think they'll probably join us. It's probably travel problems. They'll join us during proceedings. Okay, could we begin with the first question? Alison, would you like to begin?
Yes, thank you, Convener. I would like to ask the witnesses who've joined us this morning how they would define the preventative agenda.
Who would like to go first? Go for it, Gerry.
So this is a difficult term to define, as you've probably gathered already, and so different people will define it in different ways for different purposes. I suppose a working definition that you might want to think about is spending, usually public spending now, with the intention of reducing public spending or negative outcomes occurring in the future. And it can be defined as primary prevention in that it prevents negative outcomes from ever happening, so the prevention of a cancer occurring or the prevention of a hospital admission. It can be secondary prevention, which is about perhaps preventing complications or further negative outcomes occurring after an initial bad thing has happened. Or it can even be tertiary prevention, which might be about preventing other negative outcomes, perhaps in terminal care or the likes. So I don't know if there is a single definition that everybody would ascribe to, but probably spending now to avert negative outcomes in the future is probably a working definition that most people could live with.
Okay. Anybody else question? David?
Well, I just add into that part of the issue is that makes preventative the assessment of prevention extremely difficult is the establishment of what we would call the counterfactual, which is what would have happened had the preventative intervention not taken place. And statisticians can spend a long time trying to process the idea of what the counterfactual might be, and uncertainty about that clouds the whole prevention agenda, and maybe makes politicians less willing to get in there, especially when it can take a long time before the benefits of a preventative intervention may be realised.
Anybody else wish to comment? I mean, I suppose some of the issue is about defining it, but also about what it is we should be focusing on. And that's the other question. Sorry, Alison, do you want to add anything to what you're saying?
Yeah, it's unfortunate that Dr. Irvine isn't here, but maybe, you know, I think the point she makes in her written evidence, she suggests that some evidence challenges the perception that preventative initiatives should always be prioritised. And she points, she says, employing more district nurses and GPs is necessary to enable them to react to genuine need in the community so as to minimise unnecessary reliance on secondary and tertiary care in the future. That's not preventative medicine as we think of it in public health terms. That's just intelligent, cost-effective health service planning. So, you know, I think there's another view there. But, convener, if I may, there are some of the submissions that suggest it's unrealistic that shifting resources to the community sector will actually save us cash or negative outcomes in the long term. You know, there's a feeling that shifting that to where we might see more preventative action taking place isn't going to save us the cash that we think it is. I'd be grateful for any views on that.
Yeah. Thank you. I guess I can speak from some of our experiences in Midlothian and some of the things that we've learned in our journey so far in integrating health and social care. And I think for us what's key is the opportunities that have opened up around having a different understanding of what we're dealing with. We're able now to see the whole journey rather than fragmented episodes, whether in hospital or whether in the community. We also have better data in terms of understanding our communities, things like knowing the level of smoking in our areas of high deprivation has been a real shock to us and has forced us to confront some realities, and also the opportunities around bringing a workforce together with very different skills. But key to all us and all of that is a shift in the mindset. What we're building up in terms of our understanding is we're starting to build up new interventions that are around building social networks in the community as alternatives to what previously would have been solo professional interventions. An example would be the referral of patients to psychological therapies as to address mental health issues, whereas increasingly what we've got is new interventions that looks much more holistically and looks at the social determinants. So it's about everyone understanding inequalities and seeing it as part of their job. Shifting resources from hospital to community is part of that journey. It's about seeing the whole picture. It's about much more holistic intervention and about professionals working together and having a real understanding of the context and the social determinants of some of the presentations.
Can I just ask further to that? There are some submissions that suggest that social determinants are what we need to get at. You know, we need to increase income and improve housing and so on if we want to tackle health at its roots, there are other submissions that suggest that we still need to focus on specific interventions for specific conditions, you know, like obesity or diabetes and so on. Does anyone have a view on that?
Ella?
I think there's a false dichotomy there. And I think, referring back to your earlier question as well, perhaps it's worth highlighting that those big picture interventions, the reducing inequalities, the social determinants of health end, have a very broad impact. They reduce, reducing inequalities, they will improve health in lots of different areas, which makes it much harder to measure in terms of cost effectiveness. It's much harder to see that widget A has produced outcome B when you are looking at that much, much bigger, much broader picture. And I don't think that anybody is arguing that the one is a substitute for the other, that because the impact of reducing inequalities is going to be slow and gradual, it's impossible to wave a magic wand and have that happen tomorrow. So the problems we see currently will continue to be there. The people who are developing pathologies today will still be developing them while we are making that impact on society more broadly. So trying to separate them out in that way and saying we should focus on one rather than the other, I think is actually probably unhelpful.
I think we need to do both.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Gerry.
To what Elise articulated, so absolutely we need to address income, housing, all the social determinants of health, but that will not reduce entirely the need for health and social care services. So Derek Wanless, in his series of reports that he did for the UK government a number of years ago, talked about not only the need to postpone mortality and to increase life expectancy, but to compress morbidity, so to reduce the amount of time that people spend in ill health if you're to actually generate savings for the services. And that's really, I think, what a lot of the prevention discussion has centred around, is about less about the prevention of illness and the prevention of mortality, but actually the compression of the time which people need health and social care services for in order to make the system more financially sustainable. And so the desire to compress that morbidity is about trying to keep people healthier for longer, and that clearly needs all the care around all the social determinants of health, about reducing income inequalities, housing, etc. But it also needs good, high-quality primary care and preventive services and legislation specific for things like smoking and alcohol, food and so on. So I think there would be a useful locus for the committee to focus on is about that compression of morbidity and about trying to prevent unnecessary spending and services to increase the financial sustainability of the system.
Thank you.
And just building on that point, not only is it, I think, a potential false dichotomy between investing in the social determinants of health and investing in things which might tackle behaviours. I think the argument is we would propose from Health Scotland is that we shouldn't be generalising about which forms of intervention are necessarily the most effective and cost-effective. We should be looking at the evidence to understand what the evidence tells us about which ways of tackling behaviours might be the most effective and cost-effective, and which ways of tackling some of the upstream determinants of health might be the most effective and cost-effective. There is quite a strengthening evidence base out there that we can draw on in discussions about prevention. We'd very much encourage the committee to look at that evidence base to identify which interventions across the broad spectrum of interventions, from upstream interventions tackling the determinants of health, right down to downstream interventions tackling behaviours, which of those interventions are going to be most effective and cost-effective, and potentially most effective in tackling health inequalities as well.
Yeah. Fraser?
Vina, I suppose a first point in terms of the definition, which is, and to some extent, all public services should be preventative and can prevent things. And I think looking back at Christie, the Christie report, which is, you know, a good few years old now, that's kind of where they got to. So I think the danger of talking about preventative spend is that it makes it sound like it's in a pot over here on specific projects that's designed to prevent stuff. All, whatever it is, 30, 40 billion pounds worth of public money that's spent in Scotland should be preventative. And I think there's a challenge for us all there to refocus our attention on that front, which is an easy thing for me to say, I completely accept. And I think given that the general consensus is that we need to both do the housing and the economy and getting people jobs bit, as well as more specific measures for specific issues, there is a money question there. And obviously that's where, as Audit Scotland, we are particularly interested. So I was interested in some of the written submissions to the committee about new models of funding that might be available. I think that's definitely worth looking at. And there are also, I think, whichever way you look at this, some difficult decisions to be made at some point. I was interested again in Dr. Irvine's submission where she talks about the breast screening programme. Now, I know nothing about the rights or wrongs of that. I make no comment about it. But I think it is interesting that there is someone in the field saying, well, here's a thing that everyone's kind of said is a good thing to do, but what about the cost effectiveness of that thing? And then the challenge is, well, maybe that money, if there is any money to be saved, might be better spent on housing. So there's a big question for government and for the public sector about taking money potentially from one bit of the system and spending it somewhere else. And that at the moment is a very difficult discussion to be had. So for me, that kind of whole systems approach is something that we still need to work at.
Do you think there are enough people doing challenging us like that?
I mean, it's an interesting question, Kabir. I mean, I thought the response you got to the inquiry was fantastic. 60-odd
written submissions, and what struck me just flicking through some of them was the commonality of view. And my sense is that we don't really need to do a lot more analysis of this issue, because most people are saying broadly the same thing. I think the question is, what are the actions on the ground that are actually going to make the difference? How do we free up, how do we tackle some of the barriers that everyone has mentioned, in particular around that use of resources, to help people like colleagues from Midlothian who are on the ground actually trying to make this stuff work? I think that's where the focus of the attention should be.
Alex, you can go.
Thank you, Convener. I was hoping to come in on specifically early years preventative work. Obviously, I should declare an interest, having been involved in the early stages of the Early Years Collaborative and a member of the Baby in the Bathwater Coalition, which looked to improve life outcomes for children by investing in services for them in the first 1,000 days of life. I'd be very interested. Obviously, you know, you can't get much more preventative than working from birth, and in fact, pre-birth around perinatal mental health and the conditions in which pregnancy occurs, and the support that's given to expectant mothers. But I'd be interested in the panel's reflections on how effective the Early Years Collaborative has been in terms of improving health outcomes for children in early years, where we have still to travel and the trajectory we're on, and what we should be doing more of as politicians in terms of that work.
Who's first? Fraser?
Yeah. If nothing else, just to plug a report that we're going to be doing in the next couple of years on that very question. So I absolutely take every opportunity there is, convener. So we are looking at the whole early years kind of agenda, as you say, the Early Years Collaborative being an important part of that. But I think it's a good question. In fact, just in preparation for coming here today, I was looking at online, just almost, if you like, as a member of the public. And if you were to try and find out how the Early Years Collaborative is doing or has done, given that some of the objectives and targets it set itself were due for delivery in 2015, 2016, it's quite hard to find. So I couldn't actually find anywhere that said, in terms of the infant mortality rate, which they wanted to reduce by 15% by the end of 2015. Colleagues might know, but I don't actually know whether we've done that or not. So there's a thing about absolutely great initiative, but where's the follow-through, where's the reporting, where's the evaluation and monitoring of it?
See, I think that's incredibly interesting, because being involved in the start of the Early Years Collaborative and the great goodwill that was afforded to it by the voluntary sector, that was very much an integral part of it, in terms of signing up to these very ambitious, as they were called, stretch aims within the collaborative around health in early years and health prevention, preventative work. But there was a very swiftly a cynicism sort of crept in, because we kept seeing the same money being rebadged and announced as new money. We didn't ever really see an immediate payoff for where that investment was going, or whether it would actually bring in transformational change. And my anxiety was that this was once again, you know, something symptomatic of the preventative agenda, where politicians' rhetoric, which is all very good and all very on message in terms of the preventative agenda, is never actually matched with the delivery. And I just, you know, I think that if we do anything in this inquiry, it's to shine a light on that disconnect between the rhetoric and the reality. And I think the Early Years Collaborative and the fact that you can't find, that you, somebody who works for Audit Scotland, can't find online any evidence of what this has done with all the investment and all the froth at the round of its inception. And I think that's a very worrying state of affairs.
I should probably say that my team are probably watching this throwing stuff at the television, because they will almost certainly know the answer to that question. But I offer it as an observation.
Well, could I put in a plug here for a Scottish Government study, Growing Up in Scotland, which is probably the best source of information on early years, and picking up on that cohort study, which follows children born, I think, in 2000 and 2005, something like that, over time, understanding what their family circumstances are and so on. Having that complete picture gives you the opportunity to do a better analysis, the best quality analysis of what effect the programme has had.
Is this stuff, you know, early years, though, is this completely fundamental to everything else?
I mean,
in this field,
at the time, it was absolutely the alpha and the omega of our work in terms of early years.
You're not a witness, focus. Mr. Cole.
I'm sorry?
You're not,
I thought you were looking at me. No,
I mean, a lot of this goes back to Jim Heckman's work in the States on early years intervention and the fact that, you know, $10 invested when a child is one or two or so on is far more effective in terms of a whole range of social outcomes, including health, but health is not the only one, than a pound spent when they're 15, 16, or indeed, you know, it has been used as an argument for rebalancing education spending away from universities towards school and primary school and so on. You know, the evidence is international in this respect, so there is strong support for it, and it will be good to have it for Scotland once it becomes available.
Gerry?
Yeah, I've got a few points I wanted to make. So the first question was about whether early years should be the sole focus, really, of preventative activity, and I think it shouldn't be the sole focus for a number of reasons. So first of all, the timescales. We can't afford to not prevent all the things that are happening to the current cohorts of people who are in adulthood and old age.
I don't think I suggested it should be the sole focus of preventative.
Okay, well, I think
work,
it's really clear.
I was keen to distill this down as to the earliest sort of examples of preventative work.
Sure, but I think it's important to clarify that can and shouldn't be the sole focus. But it's also true to say that you would have greater potential for prevention the earlier you start. But it depends on what you do as well. So you have to have effective interventions at that age group. So there's no point in focusing simply on an agent saying anything we do at that age group. And I know you weren't saying that, but we have to be clear that the interventions that you put in place at that point are effective, which brings me on to some comments around the early years collaborative. So in common with a lot of other programmes we've implemented in Scotland, we haven't got an evaluation framework that allows attribution of the impact of a particular set of interventions that would be badged around the early years collaborative or a number of other things that we've done to be able to say that has had X, Y, or Z impact on outcomes, either health or social outcomes subsequently. And we've done that for a number of programmes over a long period of time, and we keep making that same mistake of not commissioning evaluations that would allow us to attribute the impact at the start. Now, the approach that's been taken within the early years collaborative, as I understand it, is an improvement science approach. Improvement science is really good for checking whether known effective interventions have been implemented sufficiently within a local setting. It's not a good approach to find out whether interventions are effective or not. And so it depends on whether the interventions that have been badged up as early years collaborative work are known to be effective already. And the work that Neil has described earlier on, which looks at the cost effectiveness of a range of interventions, whether they be health, social, broader socioeconomic interventions, and compares their effectiveness, is the kind of evidence base we would want to draw from if we want to look at whether or not these things have had an impact.
And just final question, if I may, Convener, and our colleague here has seamlessly brought me round to what I was hoping to ask in my second point, which actually is the other end of the age spectrum in preventative work for older people. And I had a great privilege of chairing the Older People's Forum in this place, in the chamber, before Christmas. And I asked them at one point what was the thing that caused them the most anxiety. I expected it would be crime or loneliness, but actually it was fear of falling was the biggest thing that they cited, because of the demonstrable link between falls and mortality, in the sense that they have lots of friends who fell and broke a hip and went into hospital and never came out again. And you may remember that just a couple of weeks ago when we were debating the patient safety program in this place, I put an amendment down asking for a national falls strategy to build on the work of the government's falls framework in 2014. And I just wanted to broaden that out to ask the panel, in the spirit that we've just discussed early years, falls are definitely part of it, and perhaps you could reflect on that, but what other aspects of preventative health that we can bring to the older population?
MD, wish to comment on that? What are you doing in Midlothian?
Yeah, we're doing lots on falls, just as an example. I think the approach that we're trying to adopt is to use, to have a shared understanding of what the issues are and make sure that everyone incorporates it into their roles. And falls is a really good example. We're working with the fire service so that when they're doing work and going into the homes of isolated older people, they're also doing some falls checks as well. well and they're able to link up with us. And it's the same with every other professional that goes through the door. Lots of public education around working with groups of older people so that we're increasing understanding. And I guess much of our work is at the secondary and tertiary level rather than the primary and primary interventions. But if we're to go back to the primary interventions, then it's really about working through the community planning partnership and looking at the types of houses that we're building, the design of houses, etc., so that the lived environment is a safe environment for older people. Falls is just one example, but much of our work is also focused on social isolation, and we recognise the impact of social isolation on the health and well-being of older people. And we've had opportunities through various funding streams, the Change Fund, etc., to build up capacity across the voluntary sector and across across neighbourhoods. And I think one of the key changes that for me has been particularly important is about professionals recognising the impact of these interventions and making sure that they're well woven into the pathways so that we're moving away from solo professional interventions to a much more integrated approach that involves that educational approach, that involves the social network approach, and that the professional interventions are located within that.
Yeah. Any other comments on that issue? Yeah, Neil?
Yeah, I'd just like to address Alex's comments about the sort of ethos around prevention, and I think you used the phrase rhetoric around prevention. I think what we tried to stress in our submission was the need to think beyond that. I mean, there is an adage that prevention is better than cure, and that supports that rhetoric around prevention. We would suggest that a very strong case can be made for prevention, but it has to be made in a sort of discerning way, because prevention is not necessarily better than cure if it's not effective, if it doesn't reach the people it needs to reach, if it's not delivered in a way which ensures that it has the impact intended. So we would encourage Pete the inquiry to think very critically about the evidence that's presented to it about prevention, to try and understand precisely what it is about prevention that it's saying is effective or not, cost-effective or not, rather than jumping to conclusions that broad categories of interventions might be cost-effective or not. I think we need to be quite sort of critical and discerning in our use of the evidence that's presented to us.
Health Board perspective, I think what the IJBs are trying to do is absolutely fabulous and very much focusing at the right end. But from a Health Board perspective, the fixation, the obsession is on prevention in the sense of preventing emergency admissions. And as far as I'm concerned, that's far, far too far down the line to really count. Yes, we don't want as many emergency admissions, but we don't want as many emergency admissions because we don't want people to have the conditions that require them to be going to hospital in the first place. And that fixation, I think perverse incentive is used in the submissions, not just NHS Taysides. It on that specific indicator means that these much more sensible, I'm saying big picture again, targets or issues that should be being addressed that will have a broader impact on older people's health get ignored and underfunded, because if we can't prove that it will reduce emergency admissions next month, then no one's interested.
I just wanted to make a point around picking up Neil's last point. I think we've got to be clear why we are preventing. Are we preventing to improve people's well-being? Are we preventing in order to reduce compress morbidity? Or are we intervening to manage the health budget? When you're clear about these issues, then there is one thing that I think it's important for the committee to bear in mind, and that is if you do prevent some particular adverse event as far as someone's concerned, that doesn't necessarily reduce the health budget. You know, you've stopped them having adverse consequences of diabetes, but they then catch cancer. So the overall health budget isn't necessarily going to be contained because you've had this particular intervention. Other things will happen to people. They will die eventually. So it's important to be clear why it is you're preventing.
Eivin.
Thanks, Convener. And thanks for coming along today. Yeah, I wanted to kind of focus on the data side of it and the decision-making processes, data-driven decision-making. And I'm coming at not from a health background, but from a background where these kind of thought processes have maybe been used in a different environments. And just a bit of background, I mean, everybody you talk to, or almost everybody you talk to about the health service throws up an anecdotal example of only they spent some money here or stopped cutting this, then it would save a fortune over there, right? And there's no shortage of that kind of anecdotal stuff. But when you start to drill down into this, it's very difficult to come back with some data. Now, I understand what Professor Bell said about counterfactuals, and I get that, and I know we're talking big systems. But if you take simple examples, for example, you would know that people that smoke are going to cost the health service more than people that don't smoke. Now, I'm assuming with the amount of data that's out there, it's not beyond the wit of the people that crunch numbers to be able to factor out other factors like age and SIMD, et cetera, et cetera. Distill it down and say your average smoker costs X and your average non-smoker costs Y. Therefore, if you can spend X on stopping people smoking, you're saving Y further down the line, and you be it alcohol, be it obesity, be it falls we talked about, be it whatever. The way I would typically have tackled that in other environments is that's the approach you would have taken. But drilling down into, and maybe it's all there, maybe you're going to tell me that stuff is all there, but certainly from what I've tried to find so far, I'm kind of struggling to see that those numbers are there. Because you should be able to take this to the point where you say you spend £100,000, £1 million saving, reducing the number of falls, and that saves you £10 million on the health service, and it'll save you in that time scale based on data that we know from the huge amount of data that's out there. Does anybody maybe want to comment on that in terms of that approach and what data is there already that might help inform that?
Hey, Gerry?
I kind of feel obliged to answer that. I'm also head of the Public Health Observatory and manage a big team of data people. So, yeah, we've probably got a responsibility to provide those numbers for you. There's a couple of things that might be helpful. The first is the III tool, the Informing Investment to Reduce Inequalities tool. That allows you to model at Scotland level, health board level or local authority level the impact of a range of interventions on health and health inequality outcomes. The range of outcomes is limited to mortality and hospitalisation, so it doesn't look at wellbeing and other things that we would be genuinely interested in, but it's a limitation of the data available. It looks at hospital costs, not the broader health service costs at the moment. But I'll say a bit more about some of that in a second. So the III tool is available. It's online. It's on the Scotfo website. You can go on and play with it and model different levels of intervention. But it's limited to, I think, 11 interventions at the moment. But we're currently consulting on what new interventions we might add to the tool in the future. So if there are particular things which have an evidence base, then we'd love to add them in. The rate limiting step, as ever, is the quality of the evidence that allows us to model a particular intervention. So much as it might be interesting and important to do something on falls, we can't model something on falls. We need an intervention with an evidence base to give us an effect size for falls.
So when you say intervention, what do you mean by an intervention?
It can be a policy, it can be a clinical service, it can be anything that we can have an effect size for. So coming back to David Bell's point about the counterfactual, so usually the best quality of evidence comes from a sort of randomised trial where one group of people will have been given an intervention, another group not, and then you can look at the difference in outcomes between those two groups and see what the effect size is. Mm-hmm. So that allows us to model what the effect would be if that was applied in Scotland, for example. So yeah, That's what the III tool does.
Right.
I'm not sure if I've explained
it. I'll comment on that, and yeah, I might be right or wrong. I mean, to my mind, again, based on what I've done before, you would typically do it in a two-stage process. So you're saying if we do this and that happens, if you've got a factor in the middle that allows you to convert from one to the other, then it's easier. So, for example, if we say falls, right, you know if somebody falls, it's going to cost X, or if somebody doesn't fall, it's not going to cost that, so you know how much a fall costs in very general abstract terms. You're then looking at saying, well, if I take this policy, it's going to reduce the number of falls. You don't need to follow that all the way through. You only need to follow as far as the intervening factor, because at that point you know the result because you've already done that work.
Does that make it easy? Because what you're trying to do, you're right, there could be thousands of interventions over here and thousands of outcomes, and you're trying to map one to the other. It's a bit of a
so we have diagram. Done that for something. So we've done that for example, employment policies. So we weren't able to find good interventions around, or well-evidenced interventions around what generates employment, but we were able to see what impact employment had on health. Yeah. And so you can model different scenarios. Similarly on alcohol, you can pick your intervention there because we know what the subsequent...
Absolutely.
Yes, there's a lot of that.
So you've done that, okay.
But for a limited number of interventions at the moment because it's complex. But right. Again, we're very keen to hear what priority interventions we would people would be interested in as building into the next phase.
And is that being used to drive decisions?
Not as much as we would like, but part of that is because the number of interventions that we modelled in the last phase that are amenable to health and social care partnerships or CPPs is quite limited. Most of the interventions are actually at the level that the Scottish Government would intervene in. It was subject of various parliamentary debates and people used the data. I think living wage was something that came out particularly well in the modelling as having a big impact. And so that became part of the sort of political discussions at the time it was first released. So it has been used to an extent to inform some of those discussions. But I think to get down to the kind of detail about whether you invest in X rather than Y, it needs all your interventions, all your spending to be modelled as part of that. And we're some way away from that, partly because of the limitations of the evidence base. If I could go on and tell you just about one or two other resources that are available that do that to a varying degree. So there's the Scottish Burden of Disease Study, which we're working on at the moment, which looks at both the outcomes, so whether it be a particular form of cancer or heart disease or whatever that drives the burden of disease generically, so that includes morbidity and mortality, so illness and death. And it also looks at the exposures, so the things like alcohol or whatever that would drive that. And that's not been fully published yet, but it will be later this year. And that will help inform decision making, although it won't look at specific interventions, but it will allow you to do that midpoint and say, well, alcohol is responsible for X amount and such like, and obesity, for example. And the third thing I was going to mention is the ACE study. And I wonder if Neil might want to comment more fully on that. He's more familiar than I.
So, yeah, so in answer to your question, there are bodies of work that try to do what you have described. And I think the one Gerry is referring to is a large-scale Australian study carried out about 7 years ago that looked at a huge number, I can't remember the exact details, it was something like 200 interventions, some treatment interventions, most of them preventative interventions, modelled them in terms of the impact they had on something called disability-adjusted life years, which is basically an estimate of the extent to which an intervention improves length of life adjusted for some measure of quality of life over remaining life expectancy. So it did that calculation for, say, upwards of 200 interventions and did come up with a kind of ranking of the cost-effectiveness of those interventions in terms of the cost per disability-adjusted life year generated. So it's just a cost, a measure of how much you would need to invest in the interventions in relation to the health returns that you get back. Okay. So these studies have been done because, as other witnesses have said, there tends not to be a good counterfactual in terms of what happened to people in the absence of an intervention. It tends to be based on assumptions about what would happen based on what we know about the effectiveness interventions. So that it does tend to involve a lot of assumptions. This can lead to an issue in terms of different people modelling these kinds of things come up with different conclusions because they've built different assumptions into the model, so that can be a challenge in interpreting this sort of information. But there is this kind of information out there. There are issues then that we raise in our submission about how then you interpret and generalise to a different country, in this case Scotland compared to Australia, but it's kind of occupational hazard in a way. There is at least a body of evidence out there that we can begin to think, well, would that apply in Scotland if we were to invest in that array of interventions that they've modelled there? So there's also other evidence that NICE have pulled together the National Institute of Health and Clinical Excellence to inform their guidance. Similarly, they have done modelling work where they compare measures of the impact of interventions on length and quality of life, compare those to the cost to give some sense of what health returns we are getting back from the resources we might need to invest in preventative interventions. Some of them, if you look at the results of those studies, some turn out to be cost-saving, going back to a comment that one of the earlier panel members asked about. Some save money, some don't necessarily save money, but they do generate lots of health in relation to the cost that you need to incur to achieve them. But some don't, which goes back to the point we were also making earlier, that prevention is not necessarily better than cure. So there is a body of evidence to draw on. Its applicability to the Scottish context, I think, needs to be, you know, assessed carefully. But there is stuff that we either draw on directly or that we can repeat in the Scottish context to get results more specific to Scotland. But it's not a short-term fix in terms of having a ready-made body of evidence that answers all the questions that we might want to ask.
And I suppose the final question on that then is: do you see the biggest problem then as being that we don't have the data and the modelling, or we don't have the will to follow through on what we already know?
Being somebody who tries to produce this sort of evidence, I would encourage us to use it more. Certainly, mm-hmm. encourage us to use it more. I think there is a will to it, but there's a capacity issue there, because obviously, I think, as Gerry alluded to, there's a huge number of potential interventions that we might invest in.
Yeah.
So I think what we need to try and do is to begin to prioritise the discussion around the areas where we think there might be the biggest potential returns mm-hmm. and the biggest problems that need addressed. For example, obesity might be one that we would think about, and focus our energies on these big issues where we think there are the biggest potential returns, and try and identify within those areas which might be the most cost-effective interventions.
Yeah,
I think if we try and just ask the overall question, is prevention effective and cost-effective, we are doomed to fail.
Yeah, I mean, it's a meaningless question,
exactly.
Right? Yeah, because it all depends on individual intervention.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm just thinking through the process that you're talking about. Just pick a recent intervention as the provision of the baby box for mothers. Would that have gone through that process that you're talking about to assess whether that is?
It hasn't, to my knowledge. I mean, that might be because I'm not aware of work that has happened, but it hasn't, to my knowledge.
Okay, David.
I could speak about data all day, but can I start just by saying that I don't think we have enough good people to do the kinds of analysis that you're talking about, Ivan. That's issue number one. Secondly, in terms of your example of, you know, how much the smoker costs, we do have a lot of administrative data, which means mainly hospital data, I think, about that you can follow an individual with. And what I think we need to do to marry up cause and effect, economists obsess about causal linkages, is to try to link that data with more social and economic data that people have, and indeed even genetic data. This is some of the research now is going into the genetics, the epigenetics, where these may be sources of future disease and so on. And that's what we're trying to do with our study. We've got a questionnaire that lasts an hour and a half, where we ask people about their occupational history, their health literacy. A lot of the effectiveness of preventative interventions depends on how people understand them and how they react to the information that they're receiving. And it's important for us to be able to understand in the generality whether people do have the capacity to respond and so on. So Scotland is actually in quite a good position internationally in terms of the amount of data that it's got, but it has a way to go, I think, before we're telling a more complete story about particularly the social, the economic, maybe the genetic origins of later life health problems.
Colin. Just
to talk very practically from a small area of looking at this local data, and also, as you're saying, looking at the health, but as well as the social housing and other data. Some of the work that Eibhlin referred to that's been happening in Mid has been very much looking at that culture change and looking at that shared sense of ownership when it comes to inequalities. And there's been a lot of work done across the community planning partnership, which I think is key, to have that shared ownership, looking at inequalities. I mean, they've opted for health, economic circumstance and learning. But a lot of that has been discussed is about getting a shared understanding and a better understanding of local data. And we've enlisted support from like the Scottish Public Health Observatory, the NSS, and others who are more expert in the kind of things you're talking about that I'm not pretending that we are locally, to help us with some of that planning and help us to understand our local data. And that's been really interesting. I mean, people would have said that we had all the data, but actually as we've delved more and had more expert assistance, we've really learned so much more about our area and our people than we ever knew, which has been really, really helpful, but also really helpful to spread that responsibility across like housing, planning, other areas as well. So that's been really useful. And one of the things we've looked at from a community planning partnership, and this was led by the IGB, is looking at our gap indicators. So looking at, we had a tendency to look at how our stats were and what our trajectories were, etc., but not actually looking where we're closing the gap in certain areas. And it's really helped us with the experts coming into us, really helped us to kind of narrow that down, and that's going to help in our planning. We learned so much more than we knew, so it's going to help us in our planning and our interventions. Now, I'm not saying that we have all the resources that you're talking about and all that expertise, but it has made a big difference around the table in our planning of services and interventions.
You say you've now got, what are you going to do to close the gap, the inequalities gap, using that data?
Well, it's been really helpful. Just to pick a couple of examples, what we're going to do is, and we're very much acknowledging that nothing's going to change in the next year or so with this and getting this from the Community Planning Partnership, which again is quite difficult because some of, you know, the elected members, for example, their term will be finished before we'll see results. So it's having that commitment from people for this longer term view. But on a really day-to-day, I mean, some of the information we got about mental health prescribing, for example, has been really helpful, and that's helping us look at where we position services, how we make sure services are attractive to people and applicable to people in certain SIMD groups in certain areas. So it really has helped us to plan and design our services. I'm talking pretty much on a small scale here, but just having that information. Also, we're looking at school attendance. We realise the massive variance in school attendance between areas and between social groups. So it's really helping us to hone down some of our interventions and just helping people see things from a different perspective. And as I say, that shared ownership across services and agencies.
Colin.
Thanks very much, Convener. Fraser, excuse me, made the point earlier that there was quite a lot of commonality amongst the submissions, and I think most of the submissions argued that primary and early intervention were obviously key to decreasing demand in acute services. But I noticed that some of the submissions argue that it's unrealistic to believe that moving resources to community services on their own is actually going to reduce demand in acute services, and we're still going to have crisis intervention in both sectors. So can I ask the panel whether the aim of shifting resources from one sector to another is possible or actually realistic in terms of reducing demand on acute services in a world where we don't have the funding effectively to do both? And specifically, could I ask the panel whether they're aware of any major disinvestment decision that has actually released resources for effective prevention work?
Eleanor.
Thanks very much. I'll start with a general point, which there's a Nuffield report about moving services into the community, and what that says is that the logic that simply moving things into the community will save money is not proven, and I guess it ties back to what we were saying earlier that when you're talking at that higher level, you can be going everywhere from things which are almost certainly not going to deliver what you want them to do and don't have any evidence for them, to things which will deliver. So in Tayside, we've had an early community support model that's been up and running for the last few years, which has been targeting frail elderly at high risk of admission to hospital and building a community support team around that individual, trying to prevent them from being admitted into hospital. And in the first winter that that ran, we estimated that that had saved over £100,000 in terms of emergency admissions and delayed discharges. And as that has gone on, continuing evaluation across our patch has shown that that pattern of preventing emergency admissions has continued in some areas, but in other areas, it's not realising in quite the same way. And we don't know, because it's hard to unpick, whether that is differences in the population, whether it's differences in implementation of the model, whether it's something even subtler than that, whether it's just that what you see in one bit of the country doesn't necessarily translate particularly easily into that elsewhere. But certainly it's given us hope that there are some bits of moving care into the community which will have quite a concrete impact. It's just that we still haven't quite got to the end of that experiment, if you like.
Thank you. I would say in Midlothian we're still at a very early stage, but again, I would echo the evidence of the previous witness. Two concrete examples is Midlothian. We've used Liberton Hospital up to now. At times we've used 40 beds. From the 1st of April, we'll have no further admissions to Liberton Hospital. And instead, we will have people better supported at home, or the rehabilitation happening in a more local hospital in Midlothian. We've developed the hospital at home that supports people, to elderly, frail people, to avoid admissions to hospital. And we're now looking at targeting, getting a better understanding of the frail elderly and their pathway, where they're at in that pathway, and then targeting a more coordinated approach by community services to their needs to better support them in the community. Our evidence in terms of the work we've done up to now, we're starting for the first time to see our admissions coming down for that group in hospital. So some evidence to suggest encouragement. In terms of, I think we need to be careful not to assume that it's just a straight shift from hospital. We need to do things radically different in the community. It's about understanding our population. It's about working in a much more coordinated way. But it's also about new models of care. Without a much more proactive approach to the use of technology, to using our care resources in a much more targeted way than we've done up to now, there is a risk that for some people, their care in the community could be more expensive than the congregated setting that you have in hospital. So I guess, as an IJB, we're needing to be very thoughtful about what we're doing. We're needing to constantly test things. There isn't always a straight link between what we do, one intervention, and the impact. Very often you see a shift, and it's a whole range of interventions. And the bit that's harder to evaluate is the culture. A different culture around how we use resources, a different culture that's about really understanding what is it that'll make a difference in the lives of individuals. So it's all those things together that makes our work very complex, but we're needing to constantly be alert to what is working and testing.
Damon?
Yeah, I'm not a specialist in occupational health. My background in public health, my background is occupational and to some extent environmental health. So I say this with some trepidation amongst all the public health experts in the room. I'm getting the impression that we kind of, from the discussion, we know a lot about what we want, what is needed to be intervened on in terms of reducing ill health in the community. And I guess what the nature of the discussion seems to be around how best to configure an intervention. But I would like to also raise the point that we don't necessarily know everything we need to know about interventions in terms of what might be effective. And in particular, we don't know a lot about some of the causes of some of the diseases that we might be wanting to intervene on. For example, with the aging population, there's been a huge rise in the number of people with neurodegenerative diseases, for example, and we just don't know what causes the vast majority of those, whether the genetic, diet, whatever. So as well as interventions, I would also encourage some thoughts about trying to understand better what's causing some of the diseases we want to intervene on as well.
Colin, you?
Just to follow up on that, obviously a number of witnesses gave examples of some disinvestment. There's also a number within the written submissions as well. I appreciate Dr. Irvine's not here, but one of those, or a number of the submissions, talk about ceasing mass screening programmes. I wonder if the witnesses have got any views on those types of interventions.
To speak in relation to breast screening, I think the International Agency for Research on Cancer has recently done an evaluation of breast screening and found that on balance, and it was on balance, that it was still beneficial.
Yeah. Fraser, did you want to? No? You okay?
I was going to make a more general point about disinvestment, convener, but...
on you go, on you go.
And I think that's a very good example. Again, like I said earlier, you maybe missed this bit, Mr. Smith, but I make no comment about the specifics of that because I don't know the rights and wrongs of it, but it does seem to me that we need a conversation with the public and our communities to change services, whether that's about a screening programme, whether that's about an acute hospital or a bit of an acute hospital being closed or changed. These are very difficult conversations to have, but in order to achieve the genuine transformation in the way we provide care that colleagues from Midlothian has been talking about, we need to have that conversation. I'm delighted, Camille, to hear the mention of community planning partnerships in Midlothian, because it does seem to me that if we're trying to do this in our little bits of the public sector, it's just not going to work. So if you've got a council and a health board trying to make these decisions in isolation of each other with an integrated joint board in the middle, that's just not going to work. I think we need to be increasingly, if a community planning partnership is there to do anything, it should be about reducing inequality in its local area. And they need to be adding up how much they have collectively to spend, which in some places is a very big number. They need to figure out what they're spending it on, and they need to figure out how they can better use their people, their buildings, their money, to really target their collective resource towards reducing inequality in all the ways we've just described. If we continue to do it, and of course the danger at the moment is, as the financial pressures on those individual bodies increase, the temptation is to retreat into your own individual organisation and make those decisions on your behalf, when it's actually just at the point we need to be opening that up and having a much better conversation with communities, using the local knowledge that there is, using the data that's available, to make those genuinely strategic decisions for the next however many years. I think, you know, if we go into this with a view, to come back to your question, that we're doing these things to save money, I'm not sure that's the right place to start. I think we should be talking about what's the best thing that's going to improve outcomes for our communities. And in doing that, the evidence is, I think, that you find better and more efficient ways to work and should certainly save you some money in future.
Gerry, then David.
Yeah, just to try and answer, I think you asked two specific questions. So first about, is there evidence for disinvestment releasing savings? I would just like to remind people that there are other ways of prevention that doesn't involve actually any services. It would be about legislation, regulation, taxation, which are very, very effective ways often at improving outcomes. So just to run through a very quick list: reducing the paracetamol pack sizes, suicide barriers on our high bridges, alcohol minimum unit pricing, smoking ban in public places, the ban on alcohol discounting, all using regulation of some sort, very effective at reducing outcomes, no great ongoing spending requirement. So there are other preventative interventions that are really worth keeping in mind other than services, which are also important. To answer your specific question about screening, it depends on which outcome you're interested in. So there was a Cochrane review. The Cochrane collaboration brought together all evidence internationally from all the randomised trials around breast cancer screening. They looked at all-cause mortality as their outcome, and they found very little effect of breast cancer screening. Michael Marmot and his team down in University College London were asked to do a similar piece of work, but they looked at breast cancer mortality as their outcome, and they found a 20% reduction. You'll notice the disparity between those two. And the question is whether breast cancer mortality or all-cause mortality is the right outcome to look at. On the one hand, if competing causes of death are important, and somebody mentioned competing causes earlier on, then you might want to look at all-cause mortality. But if you're worried that the effect of breast cancer screening might be diluted by looking at all causes, and you would only expect a small proportion of all causes to be due to breast cancer, and therefore you've got an insensitive measure, maybe breast cancer mortality is a better outcome. So that's where the debate lies around breast cancer screening specifically. and hence why there's so much debate and discussion about its effectiveness.
David?
I just want to, pick up on Fraser's point. I've got a bit of concern that we're maybe learning lessons in different parts of the country, and then, you know, if these lessons are of general applicability, we may not be have the mechanisms in place to roll them out. And rolling out of an intervention is in itself quite an issue that has to be thought through very carefully. I'm on the board of a body in England called the Economic of Health and Social Care Research Unit. And we're looking at pretty big pieces of research on things like, does telehealth, a randomized control trial about whether telehealth interventions prevent emergency admissions and so on, where two fairly large populations are being compared. And I don't think Scotland is in that business. I might be wrong, but I don't think we've kind of as yet captured the notion of how we spread out, how we identify and then spread out best practice.
Claire, then I'll come to you, Marie. You've been very patient.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose I'm looking really to expand on a point that Mr. McKinley had made there about disinvestment and about changing services. And we've heard lots about we need lots of changes to services, we need to work in different ways, we need to look at things in the round, particularly with the integrated joint boards. But as politicians and as health board and council members, we're often contacted by members of the public very concerned about changes to services, closure of hospitals, closure of buildings, centralisation of services or so on. So how do we bring the public along with us if the professionals are saying this is the direction we need to go in?
Good question. Evelyn.
Engagement, communication, and I guess it is about respecting people's views and acknowledging and working through some of the differences. One of the things that we do in Midlothian, we have what we call a hot topics group that local politicians and the public come along to. We agenda the most difficult things on that group for that meeting. At the moment, we're challenged around because we're such a fast-growing area in terms of population. There's issues around access to GP practices, so that's where we come together and we talk. We talk about the issues. GPs talk about the challenge that they have in meeting the needs of the local population. They talk about the strategies that they've introduced to manage that. Members of the public will tell them how annoying and how difficult it is that they've got a triage system when they're trying all day to get through on the phone. The GPs go away and then look at what they can do to improve the triage system. But I think there's no shortcut, and we just can't do enough communicating. I think it's people, it's professionals working together as well. It's about where the public are unsure. It's about professionals being clear and having a shared understanding of what the risks are, being explicit about that, and being able to share some of this openly. I guess one of the things that we're constantly challenged about is changing the things that are well established, and there's assumptions made about the evidence behind the things that we're all familiar with. And we're challenged when we do things differently about evidence as well. But many of the things that we've done for a long time, there's very little or very poor evidence in terms of its effectiveness. But because it's been happening for a long time, people feel safe, they feel secure, and we just need to work through some of that very openly. But there's absolutely no doubt but that we need more conversations where there's more shared ownership between the public and between public services of what's happening and understanding of the challenges.
Okay, Marie. Oh, sorry, Neil and then Marie.
Just very briefly, there was some interesting evidence in the national conversation to that effect, where there did seem to be a willingness on the part of respondents to that to engage in some of these debates. And the only other point I would wish to make is to reiterate what Eibhlin said about the the need to involve people in the longer term in this, because I think there is some evidence that if people are engaged in discussions and information is shared with them about the choices that officials and service providers are facing, you know, they are willing to embrace the challenges of those decisions as well. They face up to the opportunity cost of doing things the way they're currently done, you know, which is not necessarily the best way of doing something, even though there is local support for it. And if they're offered alternatives where a good case can be made about the effectiveness and the way in which those new ways of doing things might better meet needs, then that might be embraced, even if it's not the position they went into discussion with. So I think conversation can work, but it's not a shortcut. It needs to be for the long term.
Marie?
Convener, I wonder if I could pick up on something that Gerry said, and if we could all explore another slightly politically tricky area, which is the reluctance to use the most effective or the very cost-effective options of regulation, fiscal control and legislation, which also don't contribute to health inequalities, and a tendency for politicians to fall back on individual interventions and education and behavioural change, which is much less effective and contributes to health inequality.
Gerry?
Yeah, so I agree. I think perhaps at times those kinds of interventions can be more politically challenging, even though they're often cheaper. So they can be seen as anti-libertarian. So, you know, limiting the sales of alcohol or where you can smoke or regulating the food industry would be unpopular with, you know, lots of particular stakeholders. But these would be very effective ways at improving health and reducing health inequalities because, as you say, they don't rely on individual agency. They don't rely on people having to opt into things. And it just removes the risk from, you know, the context in which we live. So they are very effective and they're very cost effective for that reason.
Can I ask, are there examples from around the world? So I note that my colleague Alison Thewlis has brought forward some legislation about advertising of formula milk. And I know that in the UK we have the lowest breastfeeding rate in the world. And I just wondered I know that there are different regulatory systems around the world in terms of advertising and formula milk, that type of thing. Are there examples around the world that we could follow on that sort of legislation?
I'm not sure if I would suspect that would be an effective way, but I'm not sure of the exact evidence. Neil, was that included in ACE? I can't remember.
The ACE study that I referred to earlier certainly refers to a number of these regulatory types of interventions and does tend to find them to be cost effective because they are low cost and they're effective, because even if the risk for each individual is not reduced by a great amount, it reaches the whole population. So small risk reductions can still have a big effect, which when compared to the low cost makes them cost effective. So a number of such interventions were included within ACE and they did tend to be found to be cost effective.
Okay, Richard.
Thank you, Convener. I've listened intently to some of the points that have been made, and particularly breast screening. A number of years ago, people were concerned, women were concerned about it, so they'd done a breast screening programme. Now we're being told it was ineffective and costly. If you've got three coughs, there's something wrong with your lungs. Go to your doctor quickly. The point is, are these programmes worthwhile? Are they effective? I've got a couple of questions, by the way. Are they effective? Are we just wasting our money?
Who would like to? David? No? David looks away. He looks away and looks at the floor. Anybody got an opinion on this? I know Helen's not here.
Nobody. I'll be controversial again. You know, we've just had smokers. It's all your fault. Well, I'm a smoker. I can't remember the last
your
time
fault.
I've seen a doctor. You know, so it ain't all the smoker's fault. But Fraser McKinley came away with a comment earlier about basically programmes. Should be, you've got people hammer individual local NHS because it's a postcode lottery. But should we not tailor programmes for local people and for local areas and for local problems?
go at that bit, maybe not the bit before the convener, but so...
Smoking, no.
No, I wouldn't like to comment on Mr. Lyle's smoking habit one way or the other. I think you're absolutely right. We need to be very careful about the phrase postcode lottery. I think what we're interested in is unexplained variation. So if a health board or a council or a community planning partnership can demonstrate why they're doing things differently to meet a local need that's making a difference, that's absolutely right and proper. I think quite a lot of the time when you ask the question, well, why is it different here to there, they don't actually know. And that's the point at which I think it's legitimate for us to ask the question and to challenge. So postcode lotteries, absolutely not, but I think unexplained variation between places or between populations or between communities is kind of what inequality is all about, really. And I think these days, with the data that some colleagues have described, we should absolutely be able to get under the skin of things and to say, no, do you know what? So we've done some work in education in the past, and these places like East Renfrewshire and East Dunbartonshire will always come out top in terms of their educational attainment scores, and people can say, well, that's because of the areas they are, and there is a bit of that for sure, but they're also the most improving parts of the country. So other councils, other local authorities are saying, well, even accepting whatever the deprivation impact might be on educational attainment in those places, there is something that those councils are doing about education that we should go and look at, and I think that's absolutely legitimate.
Last question, very thought-provoking. Do we have too many targets? What should we retain? What should we dispense with? You know, what is cost-ineffective programmes that we should abolish? I think we'll really get down to the nitty-gritty. What is the best? What is the worst? What do we get rid of?
Easy question. Andy? Any takers?
So we get rid of nothing then?
Well, maybe if we hold that and we maybe do a wee round at the end and, you know, ask people, you know, in terms of this agenda, what should we be doing and what should we be getting rid of? That's maybe, and it'll give people a bit of time to think.
Or okay? Amend. Or amend.
Or amend, yeah. In Helen Irvine's submission, she says that the task of quantifying preventative spend is so onerous because we've been determined to substitute the right solution, which is reducing the opportunity, income and wealth gap with a wide and expanding range of alternative solutions that provide a sub-optimal return on our investment. I'm very much of the school of opinion that it's the social determinants that we need to address. I've been for a long time on that. So is she right that that's what the whole focus of government should be? Because my view is that unless you have the Minister for Fishing as responsible for health and health inequality as you do the Minister for anything else, then we won't see a cross-government approach. And actually, what we should do is target the first Minister should have as their, his or her, target reducing that health inequality gap. Is that where we should be going with this? Rather than all these individual small things that we want to measure and assess, we should be assessing the top line, which is that gap decreasing? Gerry.
I think the government does have the National Performance Framework, which has a relatively small number of high-level outcomes which it is aiming to improve. So there are a number of health outcomes in there, and they're economic and housing and so on. So it covers all areas of government. And I think that's useful because that gives you a picture of whether we're making progress or not. And underneath that, there's more detailed indicators, and each department, if you like, then has more detailed indicators and targets below that. And I think as long as that's framed in an outcome-focused way where you can say, well, if we manage to address this specific outcome, that will then make a contribution up the chain to these overall national outcomes, then I think that can be useful, and it can help divide up the tasks, because if you've just got a single outcome, which is, say, improve life expectancy by X percent, that's great, but then you think, well, what do I do? What's my role in a health board, and what's the role of the housing department? So you have to divide up the tasks, and then everybody make that contribution, all seeing how they will make a contribution to that overall role. So I think as long as things are linked together in an outcome-focused way, that's absolutely appropriate, and that should then drive people to look at what is the most effective interventions to deliver those outcomes in their area. And people have already said today that often we don't know what the best, it's by history we've ended up in the place we're in. And so I think we should challenge each other more to test out what we're currently doing and see, is this the most effective way of doing things? Can we change it and evaluate it robustly and see what difference it makes? And if we find out the original way of doing it was the best way, that's fine, let's go back to that. But if we find out there's a better way, let's do it differently.
Are we seeing evidence of a substantial and significant shift in resource to the areas of most need in order to close that gap? My assertion is that we don't, we aren't seeing that, and that actually, in many ways, the rhetoric is not matched by reality on the ground, and what we're actually doing is scratching at the surface.
I think there's some truth in what you're saying, but it's complicated by the fact that the areas which perhaps have the highest life expectancy, however, also have the oldest people. And so they tend to have health and social care needs that are also high. And so shifting that resource is challenging. When it comes back, this is the nature of prevention. You've got the need now that has to be met, and another need to shift resources to address future demand, but also to reduce inequalities. And that's tricky when you're having to spend the money on the demand for services, as is the case now. So I think there's a genuine challenge there that's quite tricky.
Neil?
I think your initial question was about where we should be investing our resources and the extent to which we should be tackling upstream causes. I think Health Scotland's strategy at the moment is very much supporting tackling the social determinants of health, given their role in driving health inequalities, and the evidence on prevention, the effectiveness of effectiveness of prevention.
Can I ask you to evidence that statement?
Sorry, evidence the statement that
that's where the focus is.
I'm saying our strategy is focused on reducing health inequalities and highlighting the need to tackle the upstream drivers of health inequalities.
So that's the strategy.
Yeah.
Where is the implementation of that on the ground and the evidence to back that up?
Well, no, sorry, I wasn't wishing to comment on that question.
All right. Yeah, so we have a strategy.
Yeah. So, and I was just going to make the point that the evidence on effectiveness and cost effectiveness of preventive measures in terms of their potential to improve health and reduce health inequalities suggests as well that there are many upstream interventions which are effective and cost effective. So in our previous publications on the economics of prevention, we've highlighted the case for investing in upstream interventions on the grounds of cost effectiveness and the potential of such interventions to reduce health inequalities.
But so, and that's within the strategy, I accept that. Yeah. But that it's more difficult to then follow that through to see where there is intervention investment on the ground, which is probably Audit Scotland may be able to assist us in that. Yeah. And actually backing up that strategy.
No, and I wouldn't wish to comment on that without further analysis of the balance of spend and how that's changed in recent years, but I think it's certainly a very productive line of inquiry for the committee.
Okay. Fraser?
Yeah. And if you'd like, yeah, so I don't think at the kind of top level we have seen a significant shift in the report that that you attached to the inquiry, the Changing Models of Health and Social Care report that we published last year, says that, and I guess our urging, I guess, is that the principle of moving more care into the community is a long-standing one. It's not something that's just been invented recently. In fact, it's been a principle that's applied, I think, has been supported by governments of all different colours over the years, and we're not seeing at scale a whole system change there yet. But what we tried to do with this report was evidence that there is lots of really good stuff happening. And I think the challenge, to come back to David's point earlier, is how do we make more of that happen in more places more of the time, and it becoming a more of the starting point. And if it is difficult, and it is difficult to turn off a tap in acute and stick it into preventative or primary stuff, then we need to have a conversation about, well, are there different or innovative models of funding that will help invest There have been goals at that. We've had the change funds. We've got the attainment fund currently in education. Again, I would absolutely agree with Gerry's point earlier about, and it's a point we repeatedly make, about the evaluation of those things being built and designed at the outset rather than 5 years after us all going, well, what did we get for that money? And everyone going, well, it's difficult to tell. We need to figure that out at the start. We need to know what we're trying to do with it and measure it as we go and then have a sense of whether it's worked or not. And that's a gap for me in terms of how we do this stuff.
Okay, Alison.
Yeah, can I ask a question specifically around GPs and health inequality? I'm missing Dr. Irvine this morning because a lot of this evidence did come from her, but I know you're all experts in this field. So Dr. Irvine's work supports the view that we don't support general practice well enough in areas of deprivation to tackle unmet need and health inequalities. And she also goes on to say... Excuse me a second. That we should consider funding a high-quality GP service with continuity as the aim rather than disable general practice and then hope to solve the many problems by adding a series of fragmented problem-specific programmes aimed at patching up the inadequate primary care service that results. I'd just be interested in your expert view on whether or not we are funding GP services adequately, particularly in those areas of need.
Thanks very much. General practice funding is part of it. The underpinning fragmentation and difficulties in general practice is another aspect of the same thing. My perception of general practice from various perspectives is that it's the difficulties there are part of one of the biggest public health problems we're about to endure, that our inability to deliver the services that we want to deliver through primary care, through a lack of workforce there, through an inability to actually... So we say we want something and then we cannot actually have it on the ground because we don't have the people, we don't have the facilities there, through systematic disinvestment for a very long time at every level, and through an increasing unattractiveness of the job in the first place. We have a recruitment crisis in general practice at every level because it's not a great job to have a lot of the time. I'm really sorry, don't shoot me. That what we want, that the whole philosophy underpinning moving our care further into the community puts much, much more pressure on primary care at a time when we have less and less ability to deliver the services there in the first place. And so some of that's about money, absolutely, but lots and lots of it's about culture and about emphasis and about value in the other sense. And unless we can fix that bit, just bunging some more money that way isn't going to do it.
Okay. Clear.
Thank you, convener, and I want to draw members to my register, members' attention to my register of interest. I'm a registered mental health nurse, and I want to ask a question specifically about mental health, because we haven't really touched on that apart from very briefly with Alex Cole-Hamill's question about perinatal mental health, and really about, I guess I'm just wanting to throw open to the panel and ask them about how they see the preventative agenda and mental health services, and how they see that feeds into better services or more accessible services, or really just how they view this agenda there.
Eibhlin.
I think mental health is one of the areas that we're starting to feel more confident about the progress we're making, and particularly around the role of the GP and in the primary care setting. And I think, just picking up on the earlier question, I think one of the things we absolutely must not do is create a more fragmented service. And I think much of our challenge around when we're thinking about delivery is too much of our services, and that's where I guess we get the poorest return on our investment, is where we deliver very
fragmented services that are very episodic in response to individual things that happen. We have an intervention and then it's left sitting until there's another thing that happens. So key for me is about having really well joined up services where the GP is at the heart of that delivery but is also supported by a team around him or her that complements their skills, and everyone is working to the top of their skills but doing it in a very respectful, well joined up way. That's how I think we'll deliver best. But coming back to the issue of mental health, I guess what we've been very alert to is the number of presentations there are to our GPs where there's an underlying issue that's to do with mental health well-being, and we have piloted in partnership with the Thistle Foundation the House of Care and a well-being service. It's been very well received by our GPs. We've rolled it out now to 8 practices, and basically it's a very in some ways it's a very simple service. It's about skilled workers working with individuals who are referred by the GP because they've got underlying issues. It's about focusing on the outcomes that the individual wants, having an hour-long conversation, and then helping them to make the connections and to use a whole range of different supports that is able to help them to take control of their lives. Early results, we're engaged in an evaluation. Mairi's very directly involved in this area of work, but the early results are very, very positive. But I think what's key for us is about giving mental health visibility, calling out where there is underlying mental health issues, but using a range of responses, many of them that's about being clear about the outcomes that the individual wants, but also being clear about a range of interventions. It's about professional interventions, but they're also complemented by opportunities for learning, so that people are able to manage their conditions better. But also it's about using the strengths around them. Much, much more peer support. We have an organisation in Midlothian called Pink Ladies. It's very much focused on people using their own experience to support each other. And it's just a whole range of different community responses that we've got. And of course, underlying it, we need to be mindful that many of the issues that cause poor mental health are also to do with access to income, housing issues. So it's making sure that we're able to deliver that in a very joined up way. So we're encouraged by this area of work, and I think it's one that we're starting to make some progress on.
Anybody else want to comment on that? Just very briefly, because we've only got a few minutes left. But yeah.
Well, I just wanted to come back a little bit on that, because one of the services that, as a committee, we met on when we were out in Drumchapel a few weeks ago was link worker services working the deep end practices. And obviously, link workers are going to be rolled out across the country. And I wonder if perhaps some of the areas where you've talked about people being supported through having mental health difficulties and present to GP practices, if that's something that other areas have been looking at doing?
Comment on all of the IGBs across the country, but I know locally we as I said, we've been doing work on it. The model we're using is very similar to the link workers model. But I can't comment on the level of activity across the country.
Final question.
I just wanted to pick up on Claire and Alison's question and bring them together, because I know some of the GPs I've met don't have a huge amount of confidence when they're dealing with mental health. And actually, what's available to them, there's very few tools. And I've met with one and sort of asked, well, what's on the ALICE system for you to be able to use? And they just don't use it. So it's that sort of growth of social prescribing in the country, which I don't think seems to be happening, which actually could have a huge opportunity to, I think, build more preventative opportunities within the health service. So I'd just be interested to hear any work going on in the fields or where you think there needs to be a change.
Yeah, I would agree with you. And
whenever MD mentions developing a new directory, I start to twitch a bit, because it's really not what people need in a 10-minute appointment, is a directory to look through, well, what about this organisation, what about that? GPs just haven't got the time for that. And that's where the link workers are ideal. Somebody can have an hour, they can explore what's going on for them, and they can really then actually physically support them to a local service. Most people don't need a psychologist. Most people, tier two level, community-based, often voluntary sector run support is ideal for a lot of people. So having that support for GPs is really important. The other thing we've developed locally is a mental wellbeing drop-in, so that GPs can refer people to the drop-in or encourage them to go themselves. And again, there's somebody there who's mental health qualified who can sit with them and look at what are their immediate needs, do an assessment, but also then physically support them to the likes of Pink Ladies, Women's Aid, group work at the Orchard Centre, which is our main voluntary sector health and mind organisation. So yeah, I agree that I think in a 10-minute consultation, it's really, really hard for GPs. And also, if they don't know Pink Ladies, they're very unlikely to refer them, because they don't know, I don't know who they are, what they do, how they operate. Whereas if there's that intermediary, it makes such a big difference to the person. And you know, often people are saying, you know, I went to GP, said I didn't want a prescription, and this is looking at the social support, but they need that intermediary to get there.
Okay, thanks. I promised Richard we would do our whirl round the table at the end. So just as we go, if there is one thing that you would introduce or expand on policy area, and if there's one that you would reduce or get rid of in this field, then I know it's very simplistic, but it's really just we're looking the now at how we take this inquiry, so it will be food for thought for us about where we go on this. So, Eleanor?
I get the hard job.
You get the best one. You've got all the choices.
I suppose I'm now going to completely ignore your instruction and reflect on what Mr. Lyle said, asked earlier. I've had time to think about it a bit, and I guess that I've been reflecting on how so much of what happens is chasing the targets that are there at the moment. So Dr. Irvin mentions the four-hour target in A&E as an example. Breast screening, I suppose, in some ways, is another example of places where what it feels like we have our sacred cows that nobody is willing to unpick. And so rather than telling you what to do more of and what to do less of, I'm going to give you my mandate to unpick it a bit more and perhaps set aside the political motivations for some of these things a little bit and actually go back to the evidence.
Okay, Gerry?
So, to introduce or expand, I would use more regulation around the food industry and the food chain to improve health. And reduce, well, we've actually heard a number of people proposing a number of interventions and sort of looking for interventions for various things, which I'm not sure about the evidence base for. So I would reduce the drive to find something novel and unique and new that isn't evidence-based. So I'd urge you to stop yourself from always looking for the novel and think through, okay, if we are going to try something new, let's do it in an experimental context to find out if it really works or not.
Okay, David?
I agree very much with what Gerry's just said, and I just expand my brief a little bit. And remember, Gerry's mentioned the National Performance Framework, and the top of that list is sustainable economic growth. And we've talked a lot about trade-offs. Trade-offs get a lot easier when you have more tax revenue. So a key issue around the compression of morbidity actually is having more older workers in the workforce. And we've had a huge expansion. This is a great success story in the last few years in the number of people aged 55 and over who are working in Scotland. So the health system can do a great deal of, or can lend support to this sustainable economic growth, which in turn will relax the kind of hard trade-offs that we're talking about between acute care and social care and so on.
David?
I'll just echo my point earlier that as well as sort of interventions, we should also learn to increase our evidence base and understand more what causes certain diseases than we do currently.
Okay, Neil?
Yeah, I mean, I very much support what Eleanor and Gerry have said. I think my emphasis would be on looking to cost effectiveness and effectiveness of preventive interventions and their potential to reduce health inequalities rather than savings due to all the issues we've talked about in relation to savings. So I think that's where my emphasis would be. And also to pick up Richard's point, I think we do need a review of the current regime of targets and indicators to ensure they're consistent with an evidence-based preventative agenda.
Eveline.
If I can do say two things. Christy, let's make sure that we're still paying attention to the messages in the Christie report at a local level in terms of collaboration, and that we're really focusing on the needs of communities and working together with honest conversations about prevention. And the second thing is really to do with recognising the limitation of working in professional silos and the need for holistic approaches that embraces people's social circumstances as well as the things that professionals can do to support people.
Mairi?
Oh, sorry, that was a joint middle of the answer. Sorry.
I never even saw your lips move there. Fraser?
I don't suppose I'll get away with just saying everything that they've just said, convener, no. Okay, kind of simple one for me. I think an absolute plea to not use jargon all the time. I think the language we use around all this is problematic, particularly when it comes to engaging with the public. So that would be a thing, I think, for all of us to try and bear in mind. And the second thing, not surprisingly for me, is about the money. I think we need to renew and redouble the expectation for public sector partners at a local level to figure out how much money they've got, what buildings they've got, what skills they've got, and making much better use of those collectively for the good of their local communities rather than continuing to do it individually.
Thanks very much. We can all look at Audit Scotland reports now and expect them to be jargon-free. That's excellent. Good luck with that. The next step for this inquiry will be for us to have a chamber debate for all members and all committees to take part in that. So that's our next step. And then we will be assessing after that how we take the whole, as a committee, we will be assessing how we take the whole inquiry forward. If you've not already done so, can you please make sure you submit to our call for evidence? That would be really helpful. And could I just say thank you very much for your attendance this morning, and I'll suspend briefly for the panel to leave. Thank you. Okay, agenda item three is on NHS governance, and it's an opportunity for members to consider the main themes that have been arising this morning in our sessions, our formal session and our informal session that we heard earlier today. So could I invite any comments from members? Ivan?
Yeah, I mean, I heard a lot of things this morning, and I think there was probably three that stuck out. I'm sure there'll be more that other members will have. There was an issue about the complaints process, and a feeling that it was, in many cases, unresponsive and unreactive. And words like, as soon as they hear it's a complaint, the walls go up and you can't get anything through to them, was mentioned. Second thing was about person-centred care, rather than looking just at specific, what's wrong with you, rather than looking at the broader picture of the person, rather than a specific medical condition. And I think there was a feeling there'd been some progress in that, but a long way to go. Another thing was around about variability of service. There seemed to be an issue about different parts, different health boards and different services within different health boards. So there was a lot of variability depending on where you were.
Yeah. Well, maybe if we focus on that first, the first session that we had this morning, and if people want to add comments, then we'll come to the other one. MD, want to add anything? Who was it? Alison, yeah?
Yeah, it was just on the issue of complaints. I think the group that I spent time with, they were clearly seeking a middle way or a different way. They said in so many cases they just wanted someone to speak to fix the problem as it was in front of them. They didn't actually want to have to go through a complaint system. That was their great frustration. There was a problem, and instead of somebody being there available to talk to them, they had to go through this complaints process. I think that came over loud and clear, as did several of them had obviously experienced a review of medicines when things had got to the acute stage. You know, one person spoke about reducing from 17 tablets a day to 5, and that having a really positive impact, but it had taken a long time before there was any review, and cases of people being on medication for, you know, almost 2 decades that subsequently discovered they shouldn't have been or they didn't need. So those were two issues.
Yeah, I think on the issue of complaints and how to access the system, there seemed to be a lot of frustration about that and who to speak to and how you get an answer. And one of the participants said you have more rights and ability to complain about a tin of peas than you do about your healthcare, and I thought that was quite a telling comment. Other issues that were raised, I heard in relation to board decision making, particularly over service change, and in effect what was secrecy of how boards operate and how they maybe attempt to confuse and hide decisions within 600 page agendas that go before a committee. And somebody spoke about trawling through the 600 pages to find what they were trying to cover up, you know, which was quite a, you know, again, a telling comment. So I think the kind of governance there of how boards operate was certainly a theme. A whole number of points raised by individuals about how their care was addressed, and if you have multiple conditions and multiple appointments, then you have to go back and forward to the hospital rather than go in one day and get all your issues addressed in the one day, and the coordination of that being very difficult. And one further issue was about the centralisation of services, that people felt they were excluded from having a say in how services are developed, and that there's a lot of kind of tokenism within the process, that where people felt they didn't really have a real genuine say in what happened. There's a whole lot of other issues that came up about good practice at certain health centres and certain GP practices, where people feel they were getting good service, and so, you know, this was not just a group of patients complaining. They were actually being very constructive in their comments, and I found it very helpful this morning. Anybody else? Claire?
Thanks, convener. And I think that was an area that I picked up on too, because as well as obviously, you know, people need to hear that you're listening to their difficulties, but I did ask each group what they felt were positives and what they saw was good areas of clinical care, and how they could perhaps expand on that. What made it a good
episode of care or a good interaction with the health service. And I think everyone said it was about that one-to-one, about being heard, being listened to, and feeling that the healthcare professional had time for them. So I thought that was quite telling right across all of those groups, because they'd had interactions with lots of different parts of the health service. It wasn't just one particular department.
Any other comments on that? Yeah, Miles.
A wider point, I think what's really important, and you know, from the limited time I've been in MSP, what I've really found quite shocking is we need to build confidence in people that they can influence the health service when changes are happening. And I think, sadly, too often people feel that the judge and jury is the health board. They've decided this and they'll make the facts fit an argument. And as someone who's been involved both with the Edinburgh centralisation of Edinburgh's cleft lip and palate surgery unit and the CIC in Glasgow, I think when you actually see the evidence which campaigners are putting forward and then the actual people involved in that decision making within the health board, it's sometimes very difficult to separate the two when they're taking these decisions. And I think that's something we really need to try to focus on, to change in NHS governance, so people have the confidence in the health service. There's huge changes, yes, to maybe make in the future in our health service, but we need to get that right so that people make sure that their voice isn't just listened to, it's actually heard.
Any other comments? Okay, I know a number of us will have scribbled notes, and I've got loads here that I'll pass on. So that we take account of people's comments, and you know, we had the Parliament staff taking notes as well, so we will capture all of that and what people said this morning. I just want to put on the record their thanks for them coming in this morning. I know it wasn't easy for many of them travelling, but it was much appreciated, and I thought it was very helpful. We did agree at a previous meeting that we would now go into private session for the next item, so that's what we'll do.